Greetings, Earthlings. The start of a new build. I haven't made a Star Wars subject in, well, forever. So I thought I'd give this one a go. This is AMT Earthlings' old kit. Imperial TIE Fighters. Note the plural. There's actually two TIE Fighter kits in here. Now, this is a really old kit. It came out in 1997. Which, actually, think about it, in terms of a lot of Star Wars kits, is actually not that old. But this kit is very much of its age. Now, it has been reissued recently as a single kit with, I think, some retooling. I think some of the details have been sharpened up. The wings, whatever you want to call them, have been redone because the proportions of the ones in this kit are a little bit off, but otherwise it's the same kit tidied up, and obviously it's a bit cheaper, you only get one in the box, but I managed to get this for a good price, and I thought, well, if I mess one up, at least I've got another one, which perhaps is not the right way to look at it, but there you go. So this is what I'm going to be doing. I'm going to get the plastic wrap of this. As you can see, it's still shrink wrapped. And I'm going to have a look and see what's in it and let you know what that is. Okay, so having got the lid off the battered box, let's have a look what's in it. I've removed everything from its plastic bags. These are usually supplied in poly bags. So there is a base piece here. This is obviously supposed to represent the surface of the Death Star. And it's got some kind of pretend greedy detail in it. I'm not too impressed with that, and I probably won't be using it, but at least there's something a bit more interesting, say, than just a normal stand. There's two slots here where these stands go. Well, yeah, probably won't use that. And then we get to the actual TIE Fighter parts. So you get two identical sprues like this. Having said that, identical. If you hold them the same way up, perhaps so. No, actually, that's a weird thing. I assume they were identical. In fact, they're not. They're kind of mirror images. That's interesting. I wasn't expecting that. Anyway, two sprues that are very similar. Obviously, this is the main sort of fuselage, body, hull, call it what you will, of the TIE Fighter. There's some parts here for the cockpit interior. I'll go into a bit more detail in those later. There's some bits there for the sort of outer hubs of the wings, front of the cockpit, or cockpit stuff, rear of the cockpit, the cockpit window frame, and the sort of cockpit top. Detail on these is kind of, it's not too bad. I've certainly seen a lot worse. It's a little bit soft, very much of its time. So two of those. And let's have a look, two of these. Are these identical? Actually, they're not, are they? Or are they? I'm fooling myself up. No, these two sprues are mirror images. So it looks like this was actually tooled to be one kit in, or two kits in one pass of the moulds, which is a bit odd. Anyway, these have the pilot figure, sort of two halves and some separate arms. They have some detail here for the front of the hull. They have some detail here for the rear of the hull. These are the ports for the engines. And they have what appears to be a reclining chair. I think this is the captain's chair at a Star Trek. We don't know what it's doing here. And they have detail for the front of the cockpit. Then there is a clear sprue. Mine is coming apart a bit. So it has two of these sort of plastic stands, transparent plastic stands that fit onto the base that we saw earlier. And this one has a similar one. And you can see these have fallen off, but in fact, there are some transparencies here for the front of the cockpit, which is fine, nice separate thing. And obviously, two of those. And there's also a sort of transparent part here for the top of the cockpit. Now, this is on the real inverted commas thing. When I say real thing, you have to get used to this. When I say real thing, I'm going to mean the basically the studio miniatures. So on the studio miniatures, this was basically just the top of the sort of cockpit. The intention, I think, was that the rear of the cockpit is the hatch, and this thing here is not a hatch. It's just a look a viewport. So there are those sort of few sort of thin windows that will go over there. This is configured as a hatch, though. You can see if I hand in the way, you can see that there is a hinge there. So when this is completed, if you set that up properly, that will open up and you'll be able to see into the cockpit. I will not be doing that, and I'll explain why in a bit. So those out of the way. And I should point out that it's actually quite interesting that they've got transparencies. The original filming miniatures actually had no transparencies in them. The problem they had was that because they're filming against a blue screen, if they filmed anything with actually sort of shiny, anything shiny on it, glass or perspex or even just glossy paint, it basically the blue background would reflect on it. And because the effects process, the printing process, was actually designed to remove anything that was blue, then any shiny kits would just have big holes in them and you could see the background through them. And I did get around this eventually by, I think, this clever matting techniques. But for the original A New Hope, it was an issue, and that's why the filming miniatures for the TIE fighters, the X-wings, the Millennium Falcon, basically everything, certainly in that first film, did not have any glass in the windows. So it must have been fairly chilly in the ships. Next up, final sprue. It's this. These are the no prizes for guessing. These are the wings. I'm going to call these wings. There's some conjecture as to what these are. I've heard them called solar panels, which doesn't seem to make a lot of sense to me. I've seen them called ion collectors, which appears even less sensible to me. I think in some of the references, like the Dorling Kindersley stuff, they are referred to as radiators, and they're designed to radiate heat that is generated by the ship's sort of engines and weapon systems, which makes a little bit more sense, but not all that much. But they do look cool, and they give the ships their distinctive shape. These are a little off in shape. They should be narrower at the top and bottom, I think, but they're not horrible. I've heard things about these that say, oh, the proportions are way off on the wings, and really need to be altered. And they have been fixed for the newer release, but these don't offend me as much as I thought they would. So that's fine. I'll be quite happily using these. Okay, so we can see there's some quite nice detail there on the hubs. Not bad, not bad. So basically my plan for this kit is to kind of chuck it together and see what I get. I'll only be building one of these at the moment. I'm hoping that I'll be able to learn lots of good stuff from building the first one that will allow me to do a super duper job on the second one. But we'll have to see how that turns out. So that's it for the plastic parts. Joining the official Star Wars fan club, maybe later. Join the blue printer and get some AMT related stuff. Nope. And here we have the instruction sheet. Let me remove the base of the box and we can take a look at the instructions. There's a bit of stuff about just how to assemble, the colours needed. There's actually a surprising number of them. Black, grey, white, red, grey, blue, and then it just tells you whether they need to be medium, dark, or light, or flat, or gloss. Basically, I'll be doing everything in flat. And then we're on to the instructions, making the pilot and the cockpit sort of assembly first. Then we're adding the spurious hatch to the top of the sort of cockpit pod, putting the cockpit interior in there, putting the guns on the front, and then fitting the back hatch and the sort of front of the transparencies, and then adding the various bits and pieces here. So there's two front bits and the two engine bits at the back, and then we just add the wings and the hubs, and then display them on the supplied stand and admire it. So, seems straightforward. This is where I'm going to start getting nitpicky. These were actually originally billed, I think, as being 1 to 48 scale. For some reason, that's now been, they've now kind of backtracked a bit on that, and they now describe them as 1 to 51st scale, which sounds like sort of a Revel type scale. We used to call these pi to the 917th scale. It's just some really bizarre, sort of nonsensical scale. My guess is that somebody has actually measured these against the sort of semi-official canonical measurements for these ships and has decided that actually they're slightly smaller than 1/48. And it could well be because the proportions are a bit off on the solar panels, wings, things. So that's probably that. I basically consider this as being 1 to 48th. The rehashed one is sold as 1 to 48th, even though the cockpit pod and everything is exactly the same as before. It's only the sort of wings that have changed in size. So that is my guess as to why the sort of scale has changed, just because the wings have changed. Anyway, it's fairly clear to me that whoever designed this had never really looked at what the cockpit of a TIE fighter looks like actually in A New Hope. You know, you get a few shots of it and you get an idea of what they look like. It doesn't look like this. This one looks to me eerily like the old, I don't know if you remember the old NPC kits of Darth Vader's TIE fighter, that they're about 1 to 30th scale or something, 1 to 35th, something like that. And they had like a kind of guessed out cockpit interior. Now, in the film, Darth Vader's TIE fighter has the same cockpit as the other TIE fighters. It literally is the same set. They didn't bother to build a new set just for that. Which is why it has the hexagonal window in the back, even though there's no place on his TIE fighter for that actually to be a window. But it doesn't have anything like this, really. About the only thing they've got right is the grid on the floor, I think. The actual sort of set for the TIE fighter has a much more uncomfortable-looking chair. It's very sort of upright sort of chair. There's no consoles on the side of it. The pilot sits in it and has a sort of like a crescent-shaped control yoke that comes out of the floor in front of him, and that's how he flies the ship. There's no such control yoke here, nothing like that. The rear wall, if you watch the film, you'll see the rear wall is basically blank, except it has a sort of a hexagonal window in it, and that window corresponds, hexagonal, octagonal, corresponds to the window in the back of the TIE fighter hull, although it doesn't quite correspond to it because it'd be too high for that, but leave that for the moment. There's nothing like that here. It's just this sort of interesting chunky pattern. So the seat's completely wrong, the controls are missing, the figure kind of would need to be altered to fit more upright, It's the rear of the hull is completely wrong, or the rear of the cockpit. The cockpit sides are also completely wrong. There should be they shouldn't be this shape. There's nothing. There really should be nothing on there on these bits. There should instead be just kind of sort of lots of triangular sort of sections that have red markings on them that light up. So yeah, it's not too great. There should also be on the inside here, there should be a little thing that looks a bit like a rear view mirror, which I'm sure it wasn't, but it was like a sort of a triangular thing here that fits, and that's completely missing. So what am I going to do about this? Well, I'm thinking about it. What I might do is make a few kind of minor changes to this. I might well cover this over with, say, plastic card or something, and just put a look at like an octagonal window bit in there and paint it black. I might probably remove the control bits off the pilot's chair because they shouldn't be there. And I might try and put a control yoke there, but to be honest, you don't see very much, and it would take quite a lot of effort to really make it good. I did think about grinding the detail off here and trying to put something else on, but really for the age of this, I can't be bothered. I think for the for this build, I'll probably just try and fix the back window, and make the chair look a bit less kind of Captain Kirky. So that's basically it. Other than that, I should be building it straight out of the box. There are no decals. There are other things to be fixed also, notably the you can't see it here, but this back piece here, I can find it. Here we go. This piece here represents the back hatch of the TIE fighter. As you can see, it's got these two exciting engine-y looking parts here, which are completely incorrect. The TIE fighter have no such thing there. On the studio miniatures, this sort of hexagonal window here, it's the one I mentioned before. It was actually intended to be a window, so the idea is that the pilot can look out backwards through there. It doesn't actually correspond very well with the set because it's far too big and far too low down, and the set is much smaller and it'd be kind of up here, but that is the kind of the idea of it. So I think what I'll probably do is try and remove this and then just blanket with plastic card just to give it a flat back, because I really don't like this stuff with these two sort of engine-y things. It looks a bit silly to me. The ion engines, by the way, are the kind of two little bits that stick out the back. They're not obviously engines, but they should have a red glow to them. Maybe the next one I will try and light them. Right, so that's enough preamble, I think. I better get started on this. So let's get started on the poor benighted pilot and his inaccurate cockpit. So I'm just going to get this fella off the sprues. So the pilot figure actually looks to me not a million miles away from a TIE fighter pilot. Once he's painted up and ensconced in the cockpit, it probably look fine. I'm not going to spend too much effort on him just to get him, painted up and some details on him, just so you can see there's something in there. Now, I'm also going to work on his seat. There are some fairly chunky sprue gates on these. Okay, I might as well get this off the sprue while I'm doing it. This is the kind of cockpit front. I never really quite understood why the TIE fighter has a big glass area at the front and then two-thirds of it taken up with this, but it does. I leave these bits on the sprue. These are the sort of front bits here and the bits with the engine detail. These are actually quite nice. It's nice to have these separate, A, because they're a different colour to the rest of the hull, so they can be painted separately, and B, because they will hide what's probably going to be a fairly obvious seam. Well, these two little bits here that are in danger of falling off, these are the laser cannon, or whatever they are, cannon. Right, let's have a look at this. I'm not happy with this at all. This is the driver's seat. Don't like that at all. So I'm going to remove these bits here. Like I said, the set does not have such an elaborate seat. Don't know quite what the one was that they used, whether it was a like a repurposed ejection seat or something, or whether it was just an old seat they cobbled together out of bits of wood. Okay, so that is the basics of it. I'm just going to clean away these bits, and we should have a nice, much simpler pilot seat. Let's have a go with that. Okay, so the pilot is put together and clamped because there's a few gaps between the two parts, so he's clamped to try and minimize those. So letting him dry. Pilot's arms are separate here and they've been cleaned up. I'll attach those once he's dried. The seat has been chopped around to remove the sort of spurious armrest control things. And that's what I'm getting up with. The actual controls that are there, so they will be discarded. And I've done a bit of work on this just to tidy it up since it was there. And now I'm going to have a go at this. This is the sort of, well, it should be a window, but it's got these sort of engine-y bits in it. So what I'm going to do is try and remove the centre bit here, and I'll perhaps just blank it off with a piece of plastic card. So then I'm going to do that and move out of the way anything breakable. And I'm going to use this electric drill with a burr in it. And I'm going to grind out this. So let's see how that turns out. Right, one very clogged burr later. Managed to chop that away enough to clean out the rest with a knife. So I am going to just pare this away with a modeling blade, and I will come back and show you when it's all cleaned up. So, after a bit of filing and sanding, this is what we end up with. So now those two little engine-y bits are completely gone. We've now got a gaping hole here, but that's fairly easy. I can just put a piece of plastic card over that, glue it in, let it set, and that should be done. So that's basically done for now. And well, let's get on with something else. Well, something else in this case is going to be the cockpit. Now, this is dry fitted, and you can see that there is basically it's like five parts, a floor and four walls. Now, these bits of detail here on the insides of the walls are completely spurious, but I'm not going to do anything about them because it would be, I could grind that away and cover it or something, but to be honest, it's never going to look good. And I think if I just paint it dark grey, you probably won't be able to see it. What I was more concerned about is this back wall, because here it's got these kind of radiating spokes, and the TIE Fighter set does not have those. So I was thinking, well, maybe I should just get some plastic card, draw around this, get the right shape, cut it out, glue it on here, and then add some detail. Occurred to me that actually that's wasting a bit of time, because all I really need to do is turn it this way around, and I've got a flat surface to work with. So what I'm going to do is save myself a bit of a job. That goes back on there anyway. So save myself a bit of a job, and I'm going to sort of contrive some kind of detail here to show what the window I think should look like, and add it to that. And that's what I'm going to do next. And that, I think, will be the extent of accurizing the cockpit for this one. I don't think it's going to be worth playing with that any further. So I'm going to have a go with that, and let's see how that turns out. Okay, so that's kind of what I've ended up with for the back wall of the cockpit. I've just added some sort of cabling from Stretch Sprue. These little detail-y bits here are actually parts of the armrests that I chopped off earlier from the pilot's seat. So I'm going to leave it at that. It's just something that gives a suggestion of there being some kind of mechanical detail or electronic detail in the cockpit. So basically what I'm going to do now is I'm going to prime and paint the cockpit, including, of course, the pilot figure. Now he needs a bit of work to fill some seams, put his arms on, obviously, and get him in place. So I'll go and do that, and hopefully when I come back, the cockpit will be painted. So the cockpit is more or less done now. What I did was I chopped out some little triangular bits of stuff and put them on the back wall here, and painted the inside black to look like the window. This is very, very roughly, very, very roughly what it looks like in the actual TIE Fighter set. I put a piece of detail here, but then removed it because otherwise the seat wouldn't fit against it. But you won't be able to see that. I put just some greeblies here just to have something there. So that's it. So that's as rough as bags, but it should at least give the impression of there being more or less the expected thing behind the pilot's head. That's the back wall. For the pilot himself, actually not a bad figure, really. The hoses are look a little bit like gills, but other than that, not so bad. So basically just painted it in black, picked out the gloves and boots and helmet with gloss varnish, picked out the hoses and things with grey, and gave them a wash of Tamiya black just to bring out the texture in them. A few sort of buttons and things on his backpack, his front backpack, and also these emblems on his helmet, just painted them white and then went over them with some red paint. So again, you could probably go mad with this. If you're a real figure painter, you could probably do a lot of damage with this, I thought everything else is wrong about this cockpit, so as long as there's something that looks vaguely like a fighter pilot in there, I'll be happy. So that's fine. So again, the chair, I chopped all the sides and stuff off it, so he's holding these things in midair like Wii controllers or something. But that's basically what it's going to be. Aside from that, there's the cockpit floor here. Basically, for all of these parts, I painted them using an SMS colour that I have now forgotten. Where was it? Oh, yes, it is. This is Kool-Aid Grey, which is actually the sort of grey colour used by Japanese battleships in World War II, at least those that were built in Kure. So this is actually it's quite a nice colour. I wanted it because I wanted like a darkish grey. It didn't turn out quite as dark as I'd hoped, but it is slightly bluish, so it might be a useful kind of starting point for the colour of the TIE fighter as a whole. I think it's a bit dark, but it's a possibility. I'm probably not going to use this. I'm probably just going to use Tamiya Haze Grey because I've read that that's a very good match. But yeah, nice paint, worked well. So all I did was a black undercoat, black primer, and then some of this on. And yeah, I mean it's great paint. There's not really too much to see. I have not picked out the detail in on the sides here because it's all completely wrong, and I didn't really want to draw attention to it. So hopefully these will just disappear and blend into the background. I'm not that bothered about them. For the sort of front panel, this is what you will see through the window at the front. I've just given this a dark grey wash, again just to pick up a bit of detail. On the back there's a bit more detail, but I don't think you'll ever actually see this because this will be on the inside, so I don't really know why I bothered, frankly. So anyway, that'll go on the front. And then I also remembered miraculously to paint the inside of the cockpit roof. This is often regarded as the hatch. I don't think this is supposed to be a hatch, but it's got these sort of viewports in the top. So yeah, I suddenly realised actually that otherwise this would be white, and you'd be able to look up through the cockpit window and just see a big white blob. So I ought to do something about that. So that's what that is. So what I need to do now is to assemble all of this stuff. Okay, so you might not be able to make out too much in there, which actually is probably good. But with the cockpit closed up, this is how it will look. So you can't really see too much of the sidewall detail. You can see a bit more through the top here. Once the top hat is on, they won't let too much light in. Cool. Okay, so that is pretty much how it's going to look. And I'm going to leave the cockpit to dry now and get on with the rest of the ship, starting probably with the wings. Now, I did actually take the precaution of painting the inside of the sort of hull, if you want to call it that. I'm glad I did because you can see quite a lot of it behind the cockpit. Okay, so that's the cockpit done. I declare that done. I shall leave that in here to sort of set up nicely, and then I shall get on with the wings. Okay, so on to the wings. Now the wings come on one big honking sprue, kind of like this, and the big honking sprue is attached to the wings by big honking sprue attachment points. So look at that. So I'm going to have to remove them from the sprue without taking huge chunks out of them. So let me use these. So I managed to chop these two bits of sprue off. And what I'm going to do to try and deal with these is to actually use a little razor saw. This is, I can't remember what the name of the place is now, the name of the firm is, but it's basically the same company that owns sort of Trumpeter and Hobby Boss. And they make a set of modelling tools, including these little etched saws, etched steel saws. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and cut through here using this saw. Now, I could just use these cutters, but I'm not convinced that I'll be able to do it without tearing the plastic out of here. These are huge, these attachment points. I assume that the mold makers know their business, and there is a good reason for this. I suppose these are quite big parts, and so they need to have a good amount of plastic injected into them. but it does make it kind of awkward for the modeler to remove them cleanly, as I'll probably demonstrate by making a mess of this. Okay, so it's getting there. This will still need a bit of clean up, but it should be better than just chopping it off with just screw cutters. There we go. So that's good. That's come off quite well. There's a bit to remove here, but 2 minutes with a file will handle that. Okay, so I'm going to remove these from the sprue using the same method, and also remove these kind of lookout points as well, and we should end up with a couple of nice usable TIE fighter wings. Okay, with the wings now off the sprues and cleaned up, I can actually offer them up to the sort of fuselage or body or cockpit, whatever you want to call it, and get an idea of the actual size and shape of the finished product. So it's going to be a good size. It's not as big as the new 32nd scale one that's come out, obviously, but it's certainly, if you're used to the 72nd scale Bandai ones, it's certainly a fairly good size. Now these are a bit kind of wobbly and stuff on here, but I'm sure we can sort that. But yeah, so that's going to be a pretty good size model, I think. And the proportion of these wings, I can take this slightly off. It looks to me as though the sort of the top and bottom edges are a bit too long, but it's not horrible. It's not, I think if you weren't a Star Wars nerd like what I am, you would probably not even notice it. So I think that's it's coming along very nicely. That's going to be a nice build. Typical. Anyway, a nice build. So I'll try and salvage this, I think the next step will be to get these ready for painting. I'll prime these and get them masked, something it is a process I loathe. And then hopefully we can actually put those to one side, get the cockpit into the body, get that closed up, and we can get on from there. So lots of good stuff to do. Okay, so I've prepared this a little bit by scraping some of the paint off on these sort of mating surfaces, because I'd like them to get as much grip as I can. And if I put it the right way around, it fits better. That's always good. So all I'm going to do now is just really start getting some glue in along here and just getting that in place. There's a smidge of flash there. I'm going to just deal with that first. Now I can't remember where that even was. Oh yes, it was there. So just a little bit of flash to deal with. I mean, these molds are nearly 25 years old, so it's not surprising that there's a little bit of flash, but even that, there's not much. It's not really an issue. Okay, so let's get some glue on there and get it in place. So I'll just get some glue on that part first, get that lined up. Looks good. I mean, these will be covered by other parts, but I want this to line up as well as I can, otherwise there'll be gaps underneath the detail parts and that will look a bit strange. So just a smidge of glue there. Okay, that will set up. That looks okay. So what I'm going to do now, leave this to set up, and then I'm going to come back and do this side in the same way. And then the two sort of back edges in the same way. And then I'll come back because I don't think you need to see me actually apply a little bit of glue to bits of plastic four times. And I know I do it with panache and elan and all the rest of it, but yeah, it gets a bit tedious. So I'll be back when I've done that. Okay, so after a bit of gluing, we're in a fairly good state. The way I had to do this was like one quarter at a time, so glued this and glued this and glued this and glued this all separately, sort of held them in position. They are more or less right. This one needs a bit of work with a sanding stick. There's just a slight step there. This is not too bad. These are pretty good. There's going to be something that goes over the top of these anyway, so it'll hide them. But it won't sit flush unless I smooth this off. So that's going pretty well. Also glued these, what do you call them, pylons, I suppose. And that's why I've got these heavy duty clamps on them to keep them together. They kind of fit where they touch. There's a little bit of a gap here and here. That's gonna need, and here as well, that's quite a pronounced one. That's gonna need a touch of filler, but nothing too bad. So that is the cockpit body, fuselage, whatever you want to call it, and the pylons pretty much done. I can't resist. Offer up the wings. Okay, well, that's not so bad. That looks like that'll fit on there quite handily. Is that hard to tell there? Is that actually 90 degrees? Yeah, it's not far off it. So it's going to be a nice, good size kit, actually. Good size model. And this one as well. Yeah, this one's a bit different. There's a probably draft angle issue here where that actually wobbles quite a bit. That's obviously not right. That doesn't look too bad. Yeah, I'll probably have to just finagle that one into the right position. Because if I don't get it straight, then I'll notice it every time I look, and I'll always be thinking, that's wrong. Okay, so that's something I'll have to look out for. Might need to just shim that just to get that bit of shim at the top there, like 5 thou plastic card or something, just to get that in the right place. Still doable. Okay, cool. So all I'm going to do is apply some filler where needed and do a bit of sanding here just to get these nice and smooth. And then I'm going to apply the engines at the back and the interesting greeblies at the front. Yeah, and hopefully we'll be in good shape. And after a bit of filling and cleaning up and stuff, here's where we're at. So I've filled some of the gaps here with perfect plastic putty, which is really nice, easy to work with. And just done a bit of sanding and filing just to ease some of the sort of part lines and bits and pieces that were here. You can see I've obviously filled the cockpit window and the cockpit roof gaps with masking tape. Actually, this is full of a bit of scrunched up kitchen towel just to fill the void, and then some circles of tape stuffed into there. So now this is ready. Oh, I've put the rear bit on. This is ready now to be primed. I'm going to prime this in black. And while I'm priming this, I'll also prime the wings. And actually, thinking about before I do that, I think I'll quickly add the guns at the front here. I've already added the sort of detail bits at the front, and on the rear, these are the detail bits where these are the engines. These tiny little circular things here are the engines. These are the bits that light up red. So if you are lighting this, then oh, these are tiny. So you might feel that it's easier just to drill those through and put some fiber optics in there and just have a red light sort of underneath the cockpit or something that feeds up to those. Optionally, you could feed it out to the guns at the front. Okay, so that's where we're at. I'm going to prime everything now in black, and when we come back, we should be in a position to start masking the wings, and then getting some of the top colour on this. Some aspects of this hobby are great fun. And then there's masking. I hate masking. I've been spending about 2 hours just doing this. Basically, I've primed everything in my favourite primer, Alclad. This is the black one, primer and micro filler. I've almost run out of this, and sadly, I can't find any more supplies of it, so I don't know whether they've stopped making it. But that's a lovely lacquer-based primer, and it's got a nice sort of deep matte black finish. So this is now ready for painting. I've masked the, well, for the sake of argument, we'll call them the solar panels on the, for the sake of argument, we'll call them the wings, and they, of course, will stay black. There's no point in me painting them black over the black, so they'll stay black, and then the rest of it will be the body color. What have I chosen for the body color? Well, I'm glad you asked me that. I've chosen this. This is Tamiya's TS32 Haze Grey, which I'm told is a fairly close match to the sort of bluish grey that is used in the studio miniatures. Looking at this on the monitor, yeah, this has a slightly bluer tinge than I think this is picking up, but it's quite subtle. There's other colours that I've seen that may be close. SMS make a blue-grey in their lacquer range, which to me looks a little bit too blue. Again, you might not be able to make that out. There's just a touch. It's a touch more blue, but that's a might be a contender. So I'm going to go with this. It's a nice kind of neutralish bluish grey. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm just going to spray these up and let them dry. Remove the masking. Probably scream in horror at what I find. Touch it up, and then we'll be ready for the final assembly. So let me go off and do that, and I'll be right back. So after a modicum of painting, we are left with this. Turned out quite nicely. It's quite a nice colour. To my eyes, it feels actually slightly dark. For this sort of scale, maybe on a larger scale one, like the 32nd scale one that's just come out, this would be look a bit better. But it's nice. I'm not displeased with it. It's a fairly good sort of bluish grey. The like I said, the colour these were painted in originally was a Floquil, I think, colour called something like Stormy Sea Blue or something, or blue grey, and it was like a fairly dark colour. So anyway, it looks nice. The wings are these are all masked and have been painted. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to get the masks off of these and see what the damage is like. So I'm hoping it will have turned out okay. If not, that would be bad. So I'm just going to get this off. So the trick here is to try and get the masks off without scratching. Oh dear, I can see there's a little bit of bleed here. So the trick is to get the mask off without scratching the slightly delicate black paint too much. Oh dear. So this is, I'm going to need to touch this up, obviously, with something. So that's not good at all. That's bled under the mask. Never mind, it's fixable. Looks like it's going to be the same with all of them. Well, that's a pity, but it's not beyond redemption. And that one's actually turned out pretty well. Okay, well, I can see here I've left a gap that wasn't obvious when I actually did the masking. After it shrunk. No, I don't think it will have shrunk. I don't think it will have shrunk. Okay, so what I'm going to do, I'm going to remove the rest of these masks and survey the damage, which is likely to be, well, not considerable, but irritating. And then I shall do a bit of touch-up painting, and then I shall come back because, oh God, that's awful. So these are going to need to be obviously sorted. So for the most part, it's kind of worked, but there are points at which obviously it wasn't pushed down, wasn't burnished down well enough, and the because there's a spray can and there's quite a lot of paint going on, it's bled underneath, which is unfortunate, but can be fixed. Okay, right, well, let me carry on with this, and I'll come back when it's all sorted. Right, so I've basically touched these up by hand. They are a lot better than they were, although that's a low bar and they're still not exactly great. So that's probably about as good as they're going to get. You can see where I've kind of touched them up here. Now I'll just use a bit of black acrylic paint, so it looks slightly different. Hopefully, with I'm going to give them a coat of gloss pretty soon, and then they'll get a matte coat before everything's assembled as well. So I'll do a gloss coat and then perhaps a bit of a wash on here just to bring out the detail. And once I've done that, a matte coat to seal everything together. And that should hopefully bring, you can see here where they've had to touch this up. So that was a bit disappointing having to do that. I was kind of hoping the masking would work, but it kind of sort of did in places. The others obviously didn't burnish it down enough, and that's of course a problem. Another problem I found was that when I actually tried to test fit the wings to the fuselage, shall we say, they were not straight. In fact, they kind of pushed one way, so they were kind of skewed on the fuselage. So what I've had to do is actually enlarge this slot here, so that I can fit this in and then fiddle it to be kind of the right orientation, because otherwise these would be, well, actually one of them would be tilted one way, the other would be tilted the other way, and that would kind of look a bit weird. So yes, if you're making something, if you're trying this at home, kids, then that's something you might want to look out for. So that's another little caveat. What I'm going to do is I am going to do some detail painting on here. So these kind of bits here, these need to be a different color, and these on the back I think also need to be a different color. There are a couple of bits and pieces around that need to be, I think these are all kind of a dark gray. The sort of laser cannony things on the front, they also need to be, I think, a metallic colour, so they're either steel or sort of brass. There is not much to do on the wings. On the kind of cockpit roof, there is a bit to be done. So some of these panels here need to be different colours. Something just switched off. That's interesting. There we go. So yeah, these need to be painted in different colours. And with the parts gloss varnished and some detail painting done, we are ready to do some washes. So basically all I've done detail painting wise, picked out some of these areas in grey. These two bits at the front are grey, apparently these two bits at the back are not. I have picked out the two engine exhausts in bright red because they are red in the movies. There's a grey, dark grey stripe here. Also, there are two grey stripes or grey triangles underneath. This panel at the back is half dark grey, and that's basically it. I've done the, I've used a actually a gold metallic pen to bring out the gun barrels. What else have we done? That's all really, I think. On the sort of top hatch, whatever it is, I've picked out these areas in dark grey as well. The rest of it just stays in the base colour. For the cockpit canopy frame, this is done in, this is just German grey. Tamiya German grey, is it? Actually, I'm lying. No, this was Yokosuka grey. Yokosuka grey, I think, from SMS, which is a nice sort of pleasing dark colour that contrasts nicely. So that's basically it. That's the extent of the detail painting. Not very much required on this, really. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to try and bring out some of the detail using a wash. Now, I have sprayed this with a gloss varnish, which I conveniently put away on the other side of the room. I use this, which I got for a completely different purpose. But anyway, this is gloss lacquer. As far as I can tell, it's a like an acrylic lacquer. And I hope it's acrylic because I'm going to be using enamels and stuff on here, and I'm hoping that it's not going to lift the varnish off. The reason I use this rather than the sort of clear floor polish that I often use is simply because A, I had it, and B, I'm trying to look around to see if there's other alternatives to the floor polish. It's kind of sort of okay, but sometimes doesn't give me quite as clean a finish as I'd like, so I'm just kind of looking for alternatives. So that's that. So what I'm going to do now, because I'm conscious of starting to twirble, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to use Tamiya panel and accent color black, and I'm going to use some white spirit to clean it up. Well, in the UK we call it white spirit. In the US I'm not sure what you call it. Is it mineral spirits, I think? Same thing. So I'm just going to spill a load of that on the workbench. Great, it's going so well. So that ensures that the workshop is going to stink of white spirit for the next couple of days, and so are my fingers. But the upshot is that I have something that I can use to clean up. So that's nice. Anyway, what I will do is I will use this to put some black wash in the sort of detail areas, and also quite sort of nice detail areas. This would show it quite well. Some quite nice detail areas here, and it's just to kind of accentuate those, but I don't want to just slap a wash on them because that way always, to me, always looks a bit too overdone. I just want there to be like a pin wash. So I'm going to use some of this. And the way I use it is to just use the brush, take some of it off on a bit of kitchen towel or something, and then simply touch this and let it flow just into the details. And I know it looks like a horrible mess. But when I've cleaned it up, it will look much better. And the reason I do it this way rather than just like a sludge wash or something, or just I could just wipe black over the whole lot. I find that that tends to look like you've just wiped, you know, something over everything, wiped some dirt over everything. It doesn't quite look, it's like a different effect to just trying to make the details pop a bit. So anyway, I'm going to do this with all the details on this kit, And that shall take me a little while. And then I'll come back when I'm done. So with the panel lining done, we are now ready to start assembling. So the panel lining took ages, just took ages, but it's kind of come out all right. Detail on the sort of wings is really nice, actually. It's quite crisp. It brings out a wash, what you get brought out with a wash pretty well. Looks very nice. The hubs are particularly nice. They you know, really look, really pop with a black wash. The cockpity bit, not quite so effective. The reason I think for that is that a lot of these engraving bits here, panel lines is the word I'm trying to find, all these panel lines and things, detail is a little bit soft. It's not Bandai style or sort of Tamiya style, you know, very sharp panel lines. And also, of course, under a couple of coats of, or a coat of, thick coat of spray paint, it's not going to be quite so quite so well defined. So basically, this took a bit of care, and some lines are not as well defined as others, but in general, it's okay. I'm not delighted with it. But short of rescribing those lines and trying to reinstate all the detail, that's as good as it's going to get, I think. So that is assembled and painted, and the top bit is done, and the cockpit window frame is done, and everything's done, and I just need now to glue the things together. So this is going to be an interesting kind of exercise. These bits go like this, but there's a lot of slop in three dimensions. So I've had to, because this was being pushed out of kilter, I've had to widen this slot here, which means that now there's a bit of slop in there. So I'm going to have to eyeball that to try and get it in the right position. Also, there is a bit of give this way, mostly because of draft angles on the two sort of halves of the fuselage. So that's a bit of a pain. So that's going to have to be fixed carefully in position and held in position. Once I've got one of these in the right position, it's probably not too hard to get the other one in, because I can just stand the two together, stand it up like this, and fix one, and hopefully the other one will be able to be parallel. So that's a bit of a pain. Third dimension, it's not so bad. That way is actually right. So we're on our way. So the next thing we're going to do is to glue these bits together. Now, I've panel lined this, I haven't actually given it a coat of matte varnish yet, and my thinking there is that I don't really want to put another coat of anything on here, because I've had to scrape paint off here already to get these to have sort of mating surfaces. So I don't really want to put another coat of varnish on there and then promptly scrape it off again. Here we are, so shiny. It no longer is. It's been so painted, panel line, yada yada yada, and now given a coat of matte varnish. And the matte varnish I use, I'll show you this. This is AK's Ultra Matte Varnish. This is really nice, airbrushable matte varnish. Dead easy to use. You just squirt it in the airbrush and spray it on. So that's my varnish of choice. Varnish, that's such a strange word. Varnish of choice, and I kind of recommend it. So easy to use and easy to get hold of as well, which can also be a problem sometimes. So the TIE Fighter itself is painted and varnished, and the other bits and pieces of the model are painted and varnished. So what do I need to do now? Well, basically I can stick this to one side. Okay, that's me sticking it to one side, and I can put those to one side also, and I can concentrate on these, because these two parts, this is like the top of the cockpit, and this is the sort of cockpit window frame. These two parts actually have transparencies that go in them. Now obviously I haven't fitted the transparencies before, because if I'm varnishing them, put the transparency on, coat of matte varnish, and it will just fog the transparency. So they need to go in last before these are fitted. So that is the next thing that I'm going to do. And the transparent parts are these. This is the cockpit sort of window transparency. And this is the transparent part for the top of the cockpit. Now this one actually already kind of fitted once, and then realized that I needed to remove it, which is why it's got blobs on it. But don't worry, those won't show. Originally this part had a couple of, you can see here, these two blivets here. Basically on the original part there is a hinge molded onto here that allows you to, the top of the cockpit is hinged and allows you to open up the cockpit so that you can see inside. Now, as far as I can tell, that's not prototypical. I don't think that the TIE fighter is intended to have an opening hatch like that. I think that the entrance hatch actually is at the rear. So I'm going to glue all this shut, and I didn't want the hinge bits, so I remove them. Now, the reason I'm wearing these is that I don't want to get fingerprints on these. Now you might think it's a little late in the game to worry about that, considering I've already got paint and stuff on them, and that would be a fair point to make. But what I'm going to do, I'm going to give these a quick polish, just with a bit of rag. Here's this is an ancient t-shirt that I use for all kinds of cleaning purposes. So I'm just going to give these a quick polish just to get fingerprints and stuff off them. And yeah, it seems a bit overkill, but to be honest, knowing me, I'd get a huge fingerprint on there. I wouldn't be able to get to it after it had been fitted. And for the rest of time, I would be annoyed at not having done this properly. So that's what I'm doing. So that's one. Yes, this is enthralling, I'm sure. Right. Okay, and that's the other one. That's fine. Okay, so basically this fits into the top like this, and what I'm going to do is just tack it in with just a tiny blivet of fast sitting extra thin like that, just around the peg, and that should just be enough just to keep it in place. And the same with the front window windscreen. I shouldn't really be wind if it's in space. If there's wind, something's gone fairly badly wrong. That same here, just a touch of glue. There. Do you know what I might do is just put just a touch around the edge as well, just to help tack it in. Okay, so that is the front windscreen. Very nice. And that is that's the lid. Also nice. So I'm going to let those set up for a bit, and then I'm going to actually fit them to here. So this is pretty much done. I need to remove the masking. I'll put the sort of hubcaps on the sides here. The detail on these come up really nicely, and I think now, well, you can make that out. That's come out really nicely. Well, I should be able to fit the transparencies, and then it's just a case of putting together the stand, and that'll be it. So, with the hubcaps glued on, it's time to take the masking off and see what horrors await. So, first of all, the masking for the top of the cockpit, and there's I've packed this with stuff to just with kitchen paper. Okay, it's not too bad. The still in there. And I should be able to pop this out from the front. There we go. And that's the it's going to be the front. So, well, that's good. I think disaster was really wrong so far. So the next bit is this, which goes on the top here. Now there's no, because I've snipped off the hinges, there's actually nothing there that will locate this neatly. So I'm just gonna have to eyeball it. Okay, that's actually attached. Cool. Straighten that ever so slightly. That's good. Okay, it's looking good. And finally, the front bit, which has a notch for the top of the cockpit there. That's looking nice. Okay, I'll do the same thing I think here. I'll just run some glue around here. I'd like to just take the paint off. I don't think I can take off all that much paint before it will show, so I'm kind of being a bit careful. Put this in here, push it into place. And it's looking okay. I'll leave that for a moment. And while that's setting up, let's have a look at the stand, because I'm actually putting together a stand for this, and it's a pretty simple one. It's really, it's just a bit of rod and a base. So that's the base. It's a very simple 3D printed base. I just designed it in Fusion 360 and printed it, sprayed it black. That's all you're getting. And there is a here we go. There is a rod that goes in there. I'm going to give this a quick polish. My amazing polishing cloth. So this is just basic aluminium rod. I polished it using a fine sanding pad. And which way around does it go? It goes this way around. That fits into there like that. How's that going? That's pretty much solid. And that fits in underneath like that. And that is the finished product. Okay, so there is the finished TIE Fighter. You can't really see too much of the pilot, which is fine actually, because it's you know, it's all a bit lashed up in there. But yeah, that's the TIE Fighter. You can see the wash brings out the detail quite well. There's a reasonable amount of detail on here. It's not wonderful, but it's not too bad. There's very nice detail on the sort of wings and stuff. That's come out very nicely indeed. And on the back, obviously I've removed the thrusters that are not supposed to be there, and I've painted in the actual engines in red. Yeah, I'm quite pleased with that. I have to say actually that this build has been a lot more fun than I thought it was going to be. I mean, I thought I'd enjoy it, otherwise I wouldn't bother doing it. I'm not a masochist, but I thought it'd be a bit of a chore, but in fact, it's really been quite a lot of fun. It's not the most wonderful kit in the world, but it's certainly not bad, and it's fitted together reasonably well, and it certainly looks the part, I shall be quite pleased to display that on my shelf. That is the TIE Fighter, that's the AMT TIE Fighter. So yeah, very pleased with how that's turned out. I hope you've enjoyed the build. There will be more builds coming along soon, more reviews coming along soon. Sorry it's taken so long to get to here, but I'm kind of back at the bench now and getting stuff done, albeit slowly. So anyway, I'll leave it there, and to say thanks very much for watching. Please like, subscribe, ring bells, press buttons, do whatever it is one does. I will see you again soon. In the meantime, of course, happy modelling and goodbye.